Nikki Haley, a favorite of Sagar's, may be mulling a run for president unless former President Trump throws his hat back in the ring. At least that's what she told reporters when asked if she would still consider a run if Trump pursues a re-election.
He still has a lot of popularity. If he runs again in 2024, will you support him?
Yes.
If he decides that he's going to run, would that preclude any sort of run that you would possibly make yourself?
I would not run if President Trump ran.
Interesting. Maestro and Democratic strategist Roger Fisk and co-host of the Realignment podcast, Marshall Kosloff, they join us now to discuss. Marshall, let me start with you. The Nikki Haley situation is fascinating because she's being quite obsequious there in public towards him. That comes after she had that whole Atlantic profile, which came out like a month ago, where she actually disavowed him and apparently panically called Mar-a-Lago and he refused to meet with her. Just what exactly is going on here?
Yeah, I hesitate to say obsequious in this case because honestly, she's being honest. If Trump were to run for office, she would have absolutely no ground to run on. If anything, her run would focus on maintaining his legacy in a way that her more suburban base would be more comfortable with, and also those other parts of the party that are more traditional pre-2016 Republicans. So, no, I don't think it's obsequious at all, and it's just honest. And most other candidates, I think they probably be a little more vague about it, but that's mostly true for most of these candidates.
Yeah, no, I think that's true.
Roger, what do you make of her kind of evolution? Because, yeah, right after the January 6th attack, she was distancing herself. She kind of, you know, was disowning him. She was critical. Now, all of a sudden, she's right back in the, yes, of course, I'd support President Trump if he ran again. What do you make of that evolution and what it says about the mood in the Republican Party?
Sure. First off, good morning. And it's wonderful to be here with Marshall. You know, she's just been ping-ponging around for a couple years now. And I think ultimately people respect kind of a consistent brand, right? There's an artistic way to play news cycles, circumstances, developments, et cetera. But I think she has just so publicly flailed back and forth between being an kind of a MAGA absolutist and then trying to carve out some kind of Rubio-esque kind of middle ground somewhere. And it's just playing out in public, and it comes across as vacillating, and it comes across as weak. And I don't see how it's going to play for her. The bigger thing that I think is also very interesting about this is that now these folks find themselves in kind of the same situation that the Democrats were in a couple cycles ago by virtue of Secretary Clinton, which everyone was kind of orienting themselves in a kind of a solar system kind of way around this particular center of gravity. And that hinders the bench. It hinders the capacity to have a bunch of different voices that could bring in, different factions of the party into the primary process so that you have a robust general election operation with everyone kind of tucked in. So now everyone's just kind of waiting for Godot. And he, as I think we can all agree, is just going to drag that out as long as possible because it keeps him relevant and it keeps donations coming in, et cetera. So I don't think it's good for her at all.
I'm curious, Marshall, on that front, which is that, okay, let's say Trump doesn't run. That's where the current indications kind of seem to be going. I read it very much as her signal. Yeah, she's being honest, but like it's a public thing to make sure that he understands that she is not like an opponent or whatever. It's his. Current reporting indicates that she has not been able to secure a meeting or a phone call with him. Now, in the future, there is a world where I still think Trump might forgive her and be like, actually, Nikki Haley is my natural successor. Do you think that that's true? Is that what she would even want? How does that look?
I think any Republican in a very crowded 2024 primary would want the Trump endorsement. But like you said, like Roger said, actually, I don't see a world where that's going to come and be that straightforward, especially given the fact that it's pretty clear, especially during the 2016 primary and all this pinging back and forth, is that Nikki Haley isn't quite in that Trump camp, at least from an actual day-to-day political issue when she's giving her unfiltered thoughts. The thing that's interesting here is that building on Roger's comments, there's different categories of Republicans that we could think about. So there are Republican senators, Marco Rubio, Ted Cruz, Josh Hawley. These are senators who, regardless of Mitt Romney even, not that he would run or anything, but these are senators who actually have their own bases of support and bases of power. Whether or not that actually leads them to win, they at least are capable of standing on their own. You even have the governors, the Ron DeSantis's, the Kirstie Nomes. These are people who, because they actually govern and control a state, they also have a degree of autonomy over the decisions they make and the things they could focus on. You're seeing that in Governor DeSantis's efforts on COVID reopening, and you're seeing this with Kristi Noem's botched attempt to own the transgender issue to really signal to the Republican base where she's really focusing on. But then you have a third category of Republicans that Nikki Haley is a part of, and this is the category that I feel is the most frankly damaged in the scenario, which are the people who owe everything to Trump. So these are the Mike Pompeos, these are the Mike Pences, these are the Nikki Haleys, these are the folks who came up during the Trump administration. And because of the nature of their power there, they effectively cannot do anything if Trump is not signaling to the party that they are the successor, or if they're not capable of building their own bases the way senators and governors can.
Yeah.
What I would say is with Nikki Haley is, in a sense, she owes everything to Trump, but part of why this dance has been awkward for her is she's also one of these candidates that Roger, for whatever reason, the media just loved. Like, from the moment she stepped on the glowing profiles, the fuzzy coverage, like, that she's just one of these characters that, for whatever reason, the media decided that she should be the thing, wildly out of step with any, like, actual talent or charisma or policy ideas or platform or base of support or anything else that she might bring to the table. Why is that?
Well, I think it's because she, when you just look at her life story and her profile, it punctures a lot of the liberal assumptions about the Republican base and specifically the Trump base, right? I mean, she has, you know, more of an international kind of pedigree. Her story, that kind of thing, being governor of South Carolina, which of course is very important in the calendar. So it's very easy to kind of showcase her and put her out front as kind of exhibit A in responding to the traditional kind of criticisms of how the Republicans conduct themselves. What I think is also going to play out, and this is why this is, I think, so unwise on her part, is, you know, the Pompeos and the absolutist people, the people that would literally, like, you know, happily walk out into a crowded marketplace with an explosive vest that Trump had put on them and smile while doing it. They're gonna walk into this with at least Trump's willingness to consider. But as we know, the thing that's interesting with him, and you can go through the administration personnel, he demands that people kind of surrender to him. And then as soon as they do, he disrespects them immediately. So it's kind of an odd kind of threshold that he expects people to surpass, because as soon as they do, like with a Meadows and how he made Meadows stand up in front of the GOP caucus and literally made him denounce his own position on healthcare, and then it basically owned him ever since. It's a very odd kind of ritual that he demands of people. So she's essentially kind of already thrown in with that. And then what really attracts our attention is every time that she tries to very clumsily create some space, it is at odds. And what voters ultimately look at with people is, am I seeing this person? Do I understand who they are? And I think you could make a case, for example, in the Obama reelect, that Romney just never really sent a clear message about who he is, and people were still just kind of wondering about that. And I think she's casting herself in that same mold, where you just don't know where she's going to be on Wednesday based on what she did on Monday and Tuesday.
Yeah, I think there's a lot there. All right, guys, stick with us. We'll have more Team Rising right after this.